This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib Khan with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast, and I am here today with Maxim Lott, who has a Substack, Maximum Truth. It's a great Substack, maximumtruth.substack.com, and he is also the executive producer for John Stossel. And on this podcast, I want to actually mostly talk about COVID, although that's not going to be everything. If you go to his Substack, you see that there is a lot of COVID-related content, but Maxim has his, hands involved in a lot of different things, got a lot of pots going, boiling on his stove or whatever the analogy is, right? So we'll see where it goes. But first, I want to talk about COVID. And, I know some of you are sick of COVID. You guys want to move on. But look, it's been a couple of years now, and it's kind of part of life. And it's got this massive social, cultural, and even epidemiological impact. And as some of you know, if you follow me on Twitter, I got COVID on February 30th of 2022 for the first time. I had always wondered if I had COVID, and the test came back negative. But I definitely think I never had COVID before, because when I had COVID, I could tell I had COVID. I got exposed from a friend who got sick the next day. I got sick 3 days later. It's pretty obvious how I got it. I'm not going to raves. I'm hoping not to catch monkeypox. So, I'm not that risky. So I think a lot of you probably got COVID. You've experienced it. It's part of our lives now. And I know we're sick of it, and I'm sick of it. And a lot of us are over it. A lot of us are over masks. A lot of us are vaccinated or not vaccinated. I'm not making any judgments. But this is a social phenomenon that's going to impact us for a long time. So let me just start out with my reaction. As a lot of you know, I was a quote-unquote COVID hawk. You can check T.A. Frank's survey of the COVID hawks in Vanity Fair. I think it's from March. I started tweeting about it pretty early. I started talking about it pretty early. I still very concretely remember a Zoom call that I was on with a startup I was working with. It was still January, like January 30th or something. And I basically told them, you know what, we're not going to be doing traveling in 2 months. And these ideas that you have of making international connections are not going to happen, because you're not going to be able to go there. And my CEO of the company, who's a friend of mine, I still like him, he did kind of laugh at me and thought I was being crazy. And so that's how I felt in early February. But, we stocked up. We still got the toilet paper. So we were really into it. But, it became polarized in the culture wars. So, what surprised me? So one thing that surprised me, and I'm naive about this, so, what do I know? I did not think – I had read early on that the original Spanish flu came in waves for years and years and years. But I was naive and hopeful that maybe COVID would come and go in 1 to 2 waves. Well, we're kind of back to normal, but, we still got cases. People are still getting sick. Way more, in my opinion and experience, in terms of the impact than just the flu so far. It's a really bad flu. There are people who have mild flus and bad flus. It's like COVID, it seems like a much larger proportion get bad flus. As a startup guy, I will tell you that's really bad for my productivity. I do not like missing 2 to 3 days of work, being sick. You add that up and that's a big deal, right? So it was multiple waves that surprised me. Second thing that surprised me is I'm not an immunologist, but I have friends in immunology. And if you listen to Don McNeil, he was explaining in March of 2020, vaccines take years and years and years. So the earliest vaccine development, the pathway was like about 5 years before. And so we were in it for the long haul. And I was hoping that immunity and herd immunity and everything would kick in. Remember that back when the R-naught was way lower? Anyway, so we were wrong about that. The vaccines came really fast. Maxim and I can talk about why that is. He might have some opinions, but that surprised me. I think the last thing that surprised me, and maybe it shouldn't have, is the cultural polarization. So a lot of the early COVID hawks were on the right. I'm on the right. And, I know from the survey, a lot of you guys want to know why I'm on the right, blah, blah, blah. But maybe we'll talk about it someday, but a lot of you also complain I talk too much about culture war stuff, so I can't win, right? Anyway, so I'm not going to talk about that now. But a lot of us, like Cernovich, was part of that early group, and even Steve Bannon. The exception might be Matt Stoller, but Matt Stoller is a China hawk, if you read the Vanity Fair article. And then eventually a lot of the people on the right kind of went the opposite direction. They're like, oh, vaccinations don't work and it's just the flu. And it was just really weird. And, you know, I'm a believer in reality and truth and the empirical data. And it was people that were super anti-COVID became whatever within a month and a half. And then people were like, they were telling me that I was a Sinophobe for worrying about COVID became COVID hawks in a month and a half. People that were making fun of Silicon Valley tech bros that were taking social distancing precautions and saying that they were racist were super into them 2 months later. And, you know, people who had been lauding those tech bros were basically, you know, saying a lot of bad words about them within 2 months. So the polarization confused me and took me by surprise. So I guess those are the three things: how long it's lasted, how quick the vaccine happened, and also the cultural polarization in the United States. Maxim, can you talk about what you, you know, I've been talking for a while now. Can you give me like three things that surprised you? They could be the same.
Yeah. I mean, first of all, the polarization, when the pandemic started, you know, we're a very polarized country, and I was hoping maybe one silver lining of this can be that, okay, we're going to come together to defeat this, you know, external enemy. And for a few weeks, maybe there was some of that, but after that, it pretty quickly devolved. And I think one of the biggest things that happened, which I highlight in my Substack, is you had public health professionals just clearly for ideological reasons issuing not great guidance, like you had with the BLM protests. Those happened like at a time when everyone was saying, you know, don't go outside. We didn't realize it didn't transmit outside. Like, don't do anything in groups. And they happened, and public health professionals immediately reversed themselves and said, actually, this is okay because it's for a great cause, and racism itself is a public health issue, and they're fighting that. And so many people, including myself, saw that. It was signed by more than 1,000 medical professionals. Like, you know, these people aren't serious. They're political. And then on the heels of that, there was all sorts of stuff, you know, just confusion about whether masks worked. There's, you know, the line that natural immunity was worse than vaccine-only immunity. That just wasn't true, but it was also pushed. So there was lots of this stuff that made people extra skeptical and set the stage in a bad way for vaccine skepticism. So that's one thing that surprised me, like that polarization, let's say, and then also the kind of establishment dropping the ball as much as it did. So those are two big things. Mm-hmm. Another interesting thing is that the authoritarian regimes from China to let's say Australia, they actually did successfully keep the pandemic at bay until people were vaccinated. And that did save a lot of lives in those countries. It may not have been worth it for the freedom, but I guess I'd say I'm a little surprised that that actually worked in terms of at least lives lost calculation.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, did you read much about the crush and contain strategy? Because that's what I think what you're talking about. No matter how it was executed, and yes, it was executed by government fiat usually. So it's the crush and contain strategy. And one of the things that I remember saying is there's just no way that you can just do that in the United States. Just no way.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You know, just to recap, because I know a lot of you guys have probably flushed this out of your brain because you're sick of this. And I apologize. But you know what? You know, eat your vegetables. Vegetables are tasty. Sometimes we need to like reflect and think about this. This might not be the last pandemic we live through. OK, so this is why I do want to talk about this. So crush and contain is basically, or contain and crush, you know, however you want to say it, is you find people at a low frequency, they're tested positive, you put them at a hotel, and so they can't spread it to other people. So these are the concentration camps or whatever you want to call them. You can call them whatever you want. They had versions of them in Australia too. It was really big in Hong Kong. It's, you know, they had it for a while, I think in a form in China. I mean, really with crush and contain, what they did in China is they just like, you know, locked up people in their apartment complexes, right? So you contain it, you crush it, and then, you know, it won't spread throughout the population. In the United States, we have civil liberties. We have laws. You know, we couldn't stop interstate travel, although my friend Josiah Neely actually says there are technically ways you could do that, but we never did. People could fly. People could drive, even if there were measures supposedly to prevent, you know, they shut down businesses. They did things. Everything was really helter-skelter you know, not, let's just say there wasn't top down coordination. Let's put it that way. Right. United States was very bottom up, and that's how we rolled. Now I did and I was in a group chat, and I know you're in a lot of group chats, Maxim. I'm just guessing you are in a lot of group chats.
Yes. Right?
Okay. Yes. Okay. So I was in a group chat, and I don't know what I should say now. I will divulge, because it's been a long time. But, you know, this was in February. A lot of us were COVID hawks. We did get out to some conservative pundits. You might have noticed that some people, you know, who are accused of being right-wing demagogues were initially COVID hawks, you know. You know, there are people in the chat got in touch with, right? And so they tried to, because Trump was pretty sanguine, even though he heard other things. Okay, so in the group chat, we started, like, talking about how bad could this be. And I did a back of the envelope, assuming the case fatality rate and herd immunity of like 70% or something like that, or 60%. I don't remember. And I got 500,000 Americans. And I actually tentatively typed that out because I thought that was crazy. Right. Mm-hmm. And, yeah. And, you know, I talked to people about that. I'm like, you know, like, I remember when I calculated that out, I just was like, this is America. This is not going to happen. Well, you know, as you know, Maxim, we're hitting a million. We're in a million now. We're 2x above. And I remember thinking, like, okay, like, it's probably going to be like 100,000 at worst, because it'll be a wave or two. And, you know, and so part of what's happened is obviously the infectiousness, the R naught keeps increasing. So the herd immunity stuff doesn't matter as much. You know, like, so it was originally 70%. Like, what is herd immunity now? Probably like 90%. If it ever even happens, they mutate too fast. So that was definitely, you know, something that I think caught us unawares. Like, this infection is mild enough that we don't take precautions to crush it, but, you know, it's virulent enough that it does kill a lot of people, right?
Yeah. And, you know, it's interesting. You, Razib, take clearly a non-ideological approach to this. You're just trying to figure out, okay, how bad is this? But it's amazing how both sides, how many things both political tribes get wrong because they do take an ideological approach to a disease, which it's really not appropriate for. And I have like many examples that I've documented there of the mistakes. And I think it is relevant going forward, by the way. Like, if people are tired of it, you know, there's going to be another wave this winter, and we don't know how it's going to evolve. Sometimes these diseases do get deadlier again. And as you said, the Spanish flu came in like multiple waves. So yeah, we'll see. But, you know, I'm also like a little more right sympathetic, similar to you, but there was so much misinformation, quite frankly. And one of the things I heard over and over again was, you know, 70% of people in the UK, for example, who die from COVID were vaccinated. And that's a true fact. It sounds like, okay, most people dying are vaccinated. The vaccines clearly don't work. But if you look carefully at the statistic, 95% of old people in the UK were vaccinated. Mm-hmm. So the fact that only 70% of deaths were vaccinated actually shows that it's working. And the ratio of 95% to 70% shows that it's working really well, actually, exactly as well as you would expect from the clinical studies. So yep. This was just completely taken out of context and misled people, I think, about how well they work to prevent death.
Yeah. So this is a form of base rate fallacy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. And just to be clear what's happening here, and this is like a straightforward thing. If you don't know what it is, and I assume a lot of listeners do know, because you guys are bright. You know, I know that, you know, 50% of you have graduate educations. I just did the survey. But so base rate fallacy is basically a situation where, you know, you have these false positives and false negatives, and depending on the frequency of what you're looking for in the population, that's going to vary a lot. So, for example, if you have a test for Down syndrome that's wrong 1% of the time, it could be the majority of the time you get a positive test. That's actually incorrect, because there's so few, you know, like 1%, let's say 1% of pregnancies are Down syndrome. Well, I mean, 99% of pregnancies are not Down syndrome. So you do 0.99 times 0.01, you compare that to 1%, all of a sudden you have a situation where, like, you can't just like follow that because of the base rate issue. This is like a separate distinction where now almost everyone's vaccinated. Therefore, most of the people by definition that will die will be vaccinated, because right. Mostly vaccinated, right? And then, yeah, and you know, I have like a big Twitter following, you do too, Maxim. It's like, it's interesting. Like, I don't tweet too much about COVID right now, partly because you know, like, I think, like, I'm tired of it. Like, I just got it, so I'm probably immune for 2 to 3 months before the next variant. So I'm trying to, like, breathe. Like, I haven't been under total not lockdown since probably, I probably kind of really came out of everything in last spring, maybe June of 2021, but that was a long time. It had an effect on my family, it had an effect on my kids, especially my youngest son. And so I'm just trying to live life right now and enjoy it. But so I don't tweet too much about it, but, you know, I do track it because it's important. It affects our economy. What China does affects our economy. It affects the supply chain and everything like that, right? It affects us in deep ways. It's a public policy issue. But if I tweet about it, I have a lot of right-leaning people that are basically like, oh, I didn't know you were shit lib. And I apologize for the language, but, you know, it's just a reflex. You know, they think it's stupid to pay attention to it. And I'm not an alarmist. You know, I don't think that you should walk around necessarily with a face mask in Central Park, you know? There can be, and most people are actually moderate. You know, Maxim, I was talking to a friend of mine, and I won't mention who it is, probably because he is a subscriber. I don't know if he listens to the podcast, but, you know, he's a professor. He's a very left-wing professor at a Research One university. And he's sick of this crap. He's sick of public health exaggerations, scaremongering. He's clearly quite sick of it. And, you know, so it's not just people on the right. The issue is a lot of people on the left that keep their mouths shut because of, you know, deference to the professional managerial class and whatnot. And so, you know, it's become ideologically polarized. But, you know, most people are actually in the moderate middle. And with a lot of things in our society, that can't come out because the extremes kind of hold us by the whip hand.
Yeah, absolutely. And like you said, it still impacts us through China, which is still has complete lockdowns and just shuts down their second biggest city whenever there are a few cases. Canada still requires a vaccine for anyone to enter, which is crazy because even though the vaccines prevent you from dying, they don't prevent you from spreading it or getting it now. So it just, it doesn't make any sense. And that's the ideology on the other side where it's just like, oh, you know, if one life is saved, we should just shut down the borders effectively. And it's silly.
Okay. And so, you know, I know that we're just going on thing to thing, but there's so much to talk about. So shutting down the borders. So, you know, have you had like a discussion with your friend Ezra Klein about borders and how borders don't work as everybody at Vox was telling us in February of 2020? So it's just like super weird because, you know, they were like saying borders don't work. And the reason that they said it turned out, just people can like read up on this, but basically there was a bubonic plague outbreak in India, I think in the 1990s, and the public health people just straight up lied and said borders don't work because they didn't want people to be disincentivized from reporting plague outbreaks, right? Because if you're, because if you shut down the borders to a country, that country's public health authorities, their incentive is not to tell anybody. And so that's why they did that. And so that's one of the reasons they were saying borders don't. So the experts were lying to the media and the media was relaying because they don't know anything. You know, they trust the experts. And so that was what was going on with that. And then I pointed this out and an academic friend was like, what are you talking about? You know, because he's an academic. Experts are always right. And I just pointed him right to like the academic who admitted, yeah, we were lying. You know, he didn't say anything in response to that, you know, because whatever. Or I remember you know, and, you know, Maxim Lott is a guest on this podcast. I'm like kind of talking a little too much. So, you know, I will try to control myself. I know that some of you, but I have like a lot of stories like this. It's just like, you know, my friends in academia are telling Tyler Cowen and Alex Tabarrok to shut up, mind their own business, let the public health authorities do their jobs, all this stuff. This is back when they were actually anti-mask insofar as like they said masks don't work. This is like late February, I think, of 2020. And a couple of years later, like, look, we have to admit, Tyler and Alex's, you know, little bounty system, like they figured some stuff out. They made a difference. These institutional systems failed us. A lot of them did. I'm sorry.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, Alex and Tyler, among a few other people, were way ahead of the curve on this. And it's just because they approached it non-ideologically, I think, which is also... which is why I started my Substack, Maximum Truth. So I'm going to try to live up to that kind of hokey name, but we'll see.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, look, we all have ideologies. We all have priors. But, you know, as long as so I think part of it is like to be just like humble about that and just kind of iterate and pivot all the time. Yeah. And people just get stuck in their ways. And so, like, for example, there tends to be kind of like a cultural overhang of views that people had from, like, say, the summer of 2020 until now. And now it's like, you know, I'm not necessarily in favor of masks. I'm not necessarily against masks. It depends on the local situation. The local situation can vary. And so there are situations, like, for example, like, what's the point of me wearing a mask? Like, I can't, probably can't really get infected. I probably can't transmit, et cetera, et cetera. I'd be willing to put, like, a temporary tattoo on my forehead. I had it, you know, this is the date I had it. And so people would know.
How about a microchip?
Okay, don't freak me out, man. You're starting to freak me out. Yeah, anyway. Okay. But yeah, I mean, so everyone's situation is different, and every region's situation can also be somewhat different. And so we're stuck in these one-size-fits-all maxims, so to speak, and it's super frustrating.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and so much kind of bad reasoning on either side. Like, I don't know how Canada even tries to defend their policy, but, you know, you also see on the right-wing side this idea that vaccines, you know, are just ineffective. They've always been ineffective. And the reality is that strains did change. So when they were first released with, like, the original strain, they were pretty effective at preventing cases. Now they're not effective at preventing cases at all. But, like, these things actually just changed. It's not that people were lying to begin with. They worked to begin with. And now the natural evolution has made them not so effective with cases. Just like the flu. We need a new one every year. And even the new one is only, like, sort of effective. So this is very much in line with normal stuff, but it's sort of treated as a conspiracy.
Yeah, the anti-vax tendency on the right is very disturbing, and it's going to cost lives.
Yeah, already has. Yeah,
yeah, and one of the issues, you know, I tell my conservative friends, you know, who are doing anti-vax or they're, you know, just basically like, oh, it's just the flu. Like, the average white conservative in the United States is old and overweight.
So you're
killing your, and, like, I actually talked to I'm not going to name who it is. I talked to somebody who's heavily involved in Republican politics, and he's like, he's just straight up admitted it kind of sucks that you know, an anti-COVID position is not popular with their electorate because their electorate's dying, you know? So it's like a lot of the politicians, they're actually aware that in tight districts, they might actually lose, not this fall, but they might actually lose elections because people die prematurely who are their voters. But the voters, they want them to say certain things, so they say certain things anyway. You know, there's other things on the Democratic side that are similar, right? Where, remember, Kamala Harris was like, oh, I'm not going to take the vaccine because it was a Trump vaccine.
Yeah.
Remember that? Yeah. Oh, that was a long time ago, right?
Yeah, it's really amazing. And by the way, they have other non-COVID policies where they do that too, like the anti-police stuff. Like, murder rates are way up. They're mostly up in inner cities, and murders of Black people, that's way up because of this the police are standing down. They have for, like, the last 2 years.
Yeah. Like, it was like spring of 2021, I actually posted something on my Substack to that effect, where it's like, if you just look, you know, there's more murders, and there tends to be young Black males, like, I mean, the disproportionate group that already gets murdered. And it was April, it was the end of April, and a couple of my friends who weren't even super political were like, wow, you're really brave for, like, writing about that. And I'm like, well, what's the truth? You know, I mean, it's just the truth, so I'm gonna do it. And you know, and thank God, you know, Substack allows me to do that. Thank you, Substack. Like, you know, can't cancel me from work because, you know, I am working.
You own the emails.
Yeah, I got your email. So, stuff like that is frustrating. We see through the glass dark, or through the mirror darkly, very darkly. And it's frustrating. But, you know, you can figure things out if you try. Now, here's one thing that I haven't figured out in totality, although there's some things we understand why. The cross-cultural differences in COVID response and in COVID rates. So East Asia, I mean, even today, despite, like, some issues because their crush and contain policies don't work, their mortality rates are super low. And I know people say, oh, Chinese always lie. But, you know, South Koreans, Japanese, Taiwanese, Singaporeans – what's up with that? Do you have a hypothesis?
Well, I don't think anything's been proven, but I'll note that if you look at, say, the Scandinavian countries, you see the same thing, except in Sweden, which kind of went all out, like, libertarian. We're not going to have any rules. But the other, like, Norway, Finland, they're doing pretty similar to East Asia. That to me suggests that there is something to just this culture of, you know, relatively introverted culture, mm-hmm. you know, not hugging and kissing when you first meet someone, and huge parties and raves. It's a little more subdued, a little more polite and distant. And there might be some, and a little more kind of germophobic, I think. And I think that might be doing something in just lowering the RO in period.
Yeah, and in contrast, I think the highest COVID death rates are generally in Latin America.
Yeah, Latin America and like ex-Soviet Europe. Yeah, and I've been traveling in ex-Soviet Europe some, and I can see, you know, like a year and a half ago, I'd go on a plane and like half the people would just take their masks off and be coughing and whatever. And I'm not a COVID, I don't freak out about COVID, but still I was kind of like, you know, this isn't great. I can see how this is spreading more than it should here.
So you think it's mostly driven by lack of compliance, or just like kind of like the communitarian? Because that Wall Street Journal, I mean, I'm going to post this after I record it, so this will be a while. But Wall Street Journal has an article about Iran or Japan. It's 1/12 the American rate, and they say a lot of it is like it's illegal actually to do government forced lockdowns and a lot of these measures. But the peer pressure is really strong in Japan, right. And they conform.
Yeah, and you know, having been close to some of these cultures, like Scandinavia, for example, they're when people conform, they don't even see it as conforming. They just kind of immediately the culture is like, oh yeah, of course I would do that, you know, not get close to people during a pandemic. So yeah, it's just very deep in the culture, I think, to stay a little bit distant. And that seems to have worked. And yeah, Latin America, Eastern Europe are probably opposite, right?
Yeah.
Where like you're living with three generations in one house, and it's very jovial, open culture.
Yeah. And in Eastern Europe, you have to be inside all right. winter, which right. that could be good or it could be bad, depending on how many people are inside in the yeah. building, right?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
So there's a lot of variables that are. I hold that the coronavirus pandemic will provide social scientists with data for a generation to write papers. What do you think?
I think that's a safe bet. So
yeah, because I feel like we've been really focused on the virology and the epidemiology, but the reality is like there's massive social consequences. Like we know some of them, like, you know, they kept kids out of school. Well, that means that the kids with fewer resources will probably take much longer to catch up if they ever will. You mm-hmm. know, that's one that we focus on in the United States, but in parts of the third world, it's not that they don't catch up. It's that they stay illiterate. You know,
yeah.
There are people who had moved, you know, like city air makes free. There are people who moved to the cities, but the cities, you know, they didn't have public health infrastructures. People were dying. It was pretty dystopian. And so now there are many people like in places like India that decide to go back to their village. And they're like, yeah, I'm not going to have like awesome economic opportunities, but if I am dying of COVID, I'll have my family around me. That is a consideration. So it's having massive sociological economic effects that we're not even taking into account.
Yeah, absolutely. By the way, you know, as future waves come and stuff, I'm hopeful that drugs like Paxlovid will make it so that governments and whatnot have no excuse to shut things down like they have in all the previous waves, because they work pretty well. And Paxlovid, for example, works by disabling like a core enzyme that COVID needs to reproduce itself. So it's pretty fundamental to how COVID works.
Mm-hmm.
It makes logical sense that this is working, and it seems to be working. And I hope that'll help keep the hysteria down in future waves.
Yeah, and I actually shared this to a bunch of people. This is being shared on my group chats. You have a post May 11th on your Substack, how to get Paxlovid quickly if you got COVID. And so, you know, I shared that to a bunch of group chats, and you know, people were getting Paxlovid, and you know, so you're making a difference in the world, man. You're making in the world. Yeah.
Not to hear.
So, okay. How are you feeling about, okay, right now as we're recording, I believe we are in a recession, but you know, what do I know? Obviously we're going through some economic travails. I like to keep my podcast evergreen, but, I don't think it matters right now if I post it from a year from now or I post it this week. You know, this part of the conversation will still be relevant. You know, how is America doing? You know, I wrote some really pessimistic stuff like for City Journal at the beginning of COVID. I think we're doing better than that now. Warp speed worked. People had some uptake. And, you know, the Chinese authoritarian way of crush and contain is not always optimal, right? But I don't know. Like, we have stagflation. It feels like the 1970s. And then there's this mystery of lower skilled workers. You know, people need service workers, can't find them. My kids' camps are getting canceled. And, you know, I have a brother-in-law who, you know, he has a business. He can't find people. So this sort of stuff is happening, you know, in our society. And I think there's a real sense of ennui. You know, there's social science about younger people being unhappy. As I post this podcast, I know that I will have posted my podcast with Judge Glock, who's an economist at the Cicero Institute here in Austin. And we made a case, or I let him make a case for optimism in America, because I think my pessimism shows through too much. I've been quite pessimistic, I think, since the financial crisis after the first year or two. I don't think we had the institutional systems in America to get things done, to fix the problems that we have, and I don't think we can kick the can down the road. But, I mean, how are you feeling, Maxim? I just want to get your sense as a empirically minded, somewhat younger person.
Yeah, definitely there are a lot of problems like the ones you were saying. You have high inflation. By the way, the betting markets, I run electionbettingodds.com, just kind of aggregates the things. And it does seem like we're going to have a recession this year. That's like very high odds. And social media does seem to be having some psychological effects on people. Anxiety is way up among young people. And I hear this from young people I know. So there are a lot of problems, and hopefully society will work through these eventually. Like, we'll learn how to use social media in a healthy way. Just like, you know, the printing press caused massive wars in Europe when everyone started to have their own opinions about religion. But eventually, as a society, we learned how to kind of work with that, and it ended up being a good thing. Hopefully social media, it'll be similar, and we'll have figure out healthy ways to use it. Economically is anyone's guess. It looks like there will be some kind of recession, but that could, you know, it all depends if we quickly bounce back or not. And that I have no idea, but I'm still invested in the stock market, but I don't know if I should be.
Well, I mean, you know, you're young, go long, right? But so, I mean, you know, looping, you know, the social media information back to COVID, you know, when COVID first broke out and we started acknowledging the pandemic, you know, Trump had something, speech where he gave, and he said, you know, Google's going to do something. And I don't think Google ever did anything. So we have all this information technology that's like zooming in about advertising and everything. But, you know, aside from, I guess, like the sewage, you know, the COVID viral load in the sewage tracker, that was good. That was good information. But I feel like we didn't really leverage the information technology that we have to track our, you know, what we buy. They have a lot of compute power devoted to that. But as far as COVID, no, we didn't do anything like test and trace like South Korea to any like level of efficiency. I feel like our test and trace was like cloth masks.
Yeah. And I can tell you, I was traveling around Eastern Europe and Turkey after I'd already had COVID. And the U.S. had the slowest testing of any of these countries, you know, whether it was like Turkey or Republic of Georgia, the U.S. had the slowest testing. So this whole thing, you know, you're saying we didn't do test and trace. We weren't even close to doing anything like that. The whole thing just showed the U.S. government apparatus is pretty incompetent. And I don't see that changing. I think we just have to live with it. But yeah, it's certainly interesting to be aware of.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, it's good. It's good to get that empirical on the ground confirmation, because that's what everyone tells me. And, you know, I feel like the COVID and the pandemic showed a bit about the health of the nation. It showed some good things, but it showed a lot of bad things. It showed, you know, the water receded and there were some like serious things that got exposed. But warp speed was one of the good things.
Except, yeah.
And I mean, like I told you what I heard, I didn't hear anything like this. And this is one of the things where, okay, say whatever you want about the Trump administration. In fact, like, let's be honest. Like, let's say what I think in terms of, like, they had serious problems with execution. Whether you agree with what they wanted to do or not, everybody agrees that they had personnel and execution problems up until the end. But Warp Speed happened. It worked. Like, why? Like, what do you know anything? Like, do you have any intuitions on what's happening with that?
You know, I can't say that I know why it worked. One thing I can say is that the actual vaccine itself was invented almost immediately, like in, I believe, January of 2020. And like, basically, some researchers just used this new technology, mRNA technology, that they've been working on for a while. And they can just immediately, like, sequence things and design these things. And they did in like a day or two. And everything from then on was just about testing it, manufacturing it at scale. So it's really impressive, but that kind of makes it make more sense, right? They already had the technology. It was just about getting it out there. And mm-hmm. for once, they actually came together and did it. Like,
Well, so I was asking, an acquaintance of mine in farm about challenge trials and why that never really happened. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, the whole state of South Dakota is a challenge trial. So I don't know what that means necessarily, because I don't think they officially did trials. But, I do think we need to be a little bit more innovative about these sorts of things. Because like you said, it was always there. And if we had some challenge trials, we could have discovered it and gotten confirmed way earlier, right?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, again, it was discovered immediately. So the whole thing was about confirming and then manufacturing at scale. But yeah, it could have been done earlier. And challenge trials, so that's when you have someone who has not had COVID, they volunteer to actually be infected with COVID to test the vaccine. Like, either they were in a control or they got the vaccine, and then you actually give them COVID. And then you can very quickly learn whether the vaccine worked, because otherwise you have to wait for people to get COVID or not. And so, yeah, so as you know, it super speeds up how you can do it in theory, but in practice, it doesn't work, because you have to have bureaucrats sit around for 3 months saying, like, okay, how are we going to do this? Is this really ethical? I mean, from a utilitarian perspective, it's obviously ethical, but, people are squeamish about even allowing volunteers to voluntarily get COVID. Doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that's the situation. If we could have sped up vaccines by 3 months, tens of thousands of lives would have been saved. So it would be nice for the next pandemic if officials were working on this. The UK at least did like a pilot trial of challenge trials, and maybe next pandemic they'll be ahead of the curve.
What do you think about this current pandemic and how bad it's been? Is this like the black swan of our lifetime, or were we in just a random interglacial with very few, since like 67, with very few pandemics?
Right. Yeah, it's interesting to think about, because the Spanish flu happened 100 years ago, and it was just about as bad in terms of mortality, like actual realized mortality. Although the Spanish flu happened to hit young people the worst. So it's kind of like the same as we just had, except with the age reversed, which is much more horrible, quite frankly.
Yeah.
And then we had another thing in the, kind of in the midpoint there that was also bad, but not as bad as any of those. So just looking historically, it's pretty rare. It could be once in a lifetime. But one thing I just think is funny, if you look 100 years ago, we just had World War I, we had this pandemic. Right now we have this COVID, and we have World War I style warfare going on in Russia and Ukraine. I mean, that's a small thing so far, but
I mean, I'm hoping history rhymes and doesn't repeat. Let's just put it that way.
Right.
I mean, it's not. So, because we had a Spanish flu, and then there was like a 57 flu that was pretty big. The 67 flu wasn't anything to sneeze at. So it looks like maybe just like a Poisson process, maybe we kind of dodged a bullet. But I think we have the tools for it, in theory, not to be nearly as bad. But, we don't let's just say we don't use those tools, my freedoms or whatever. I don't know. I mean, I like freedom. Mm-hmm. I like liberty. It's just it seemed like it's – so here's the issue. I'll move off this, but – look, it did seem like some people were a little too excited to engage in public health authoritarianism. even if it was, whether it was needed or at least, so for example, some people claim that lockdowns are not effective at all. We did not know that in the spring of 2020, right? I mean, you need to experiment. You need to try things. But maybe you need to stop trying things if they're not working, right? So, you know, for example, like dietary cholesterol is not a big deal, but there are still restaurants that have heart healthy menus with low cholesterol. It's just they're not giving it up because like they have like menus printed out and they have American Heart Association stuff going on. And so it's just, you know, COVID has shown a lot of that with masks and, you know, like why are cloth masks admissible? Like they're just trivial in their effectiveness.
Yes. Yes.
You know?
And And you know, there's nuance to all these things. Like if we talk about lockdowns, yeah, they don't work in the US, but if you're going to go, you know, full China or even Australia, they'll work. We're not going to do that. We're never going to do that. But you can kind of see the left-wing impulse like, oh, we should be doing this, but it's not going to work because we're never going to go full China. So yeah, there's that nuance. They can work if we want to go authoritarian, but we're not going to do it and we shouldn't do it because we care about freedom.
Yeah. And you know, I think the final thing I will say is like also the variation of its impact on people. You know, the biggest thing is obviously age. Like there are a substantial, I mean, like a non-trivial number of people in nursing homes in this country died of COVID-19. Now, mind you, as people like to point out, these people, a lot of them would have died in the next year or two anyway, but whatever, it is what it is. There was an excess of deaths, but, you know, there are many more people in middle age and even young adults. I mean, I think it's in your 20s where the flu starts to get more dangerous than COVID, last I checked. But, you know, so it's not a big deal once you're really under 40 and you don't have risk factors. But, you know, a lot of Americans are obese. A lot of Americans have pulmonary disease, all these other things. And it's just, you know, I am technically in a low risk category. I also know I have genetic variants that are not associated with high risk. So that's super useful, you know, but it affects people differently. The
genetics from your blog having practical use.
Yeah, I mean, well, actually, like, so I will tell the listener what I did, and I posted this on the internet. You can Google it. It doesn't matter too much anymore with Paxlovid and all these other things. But what I did is, like, they published the marker, and then what I did is that marker is not in the 23andMe panel. I have my whole genome, so it doesn't matter. But that marker is not in the 23andMe panel, and what I did is I went into 23andMe, and I looked for markers using something called linkage disequilibrium. Basically, I looked for a marker that was like really tightly correlated with the causal marker. And so then I could determine if that marker had variation, if that variant was perfectly correlated with the causal marker. And I told people which one to look for in 23andMe. And so, you know, I think that's a mitzvah. I mean, I think that's a good deed for people to figure out whether they're at two times greater risk for severe COVID or not, right? Like you can do things like that. We have the information. We have the technology. If we hadn't been engaging in food fights and screaming at each other, and, you know, I think we've been like, you know, harshing a little bit on Red America a little with their behavior. But remember what Gavin Newsom did. All of these elite, you know, elite pro-mask, pro-social distancing Democrats. And it turns out like, oh, when people are looking away, they're having their fun. They're doing their thing. And the analysis of like COVID related to, I think, like birthday parties or something, like you look at birthdays and they, you know, economists figured out that a lot of people in blue parts of the country were violating in private all of the rules that they were claiming they were adhering to in public.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, there was a difference. There was a difference, but still the gap was way smaller than no adherence. So, you know, people are performing in public. Unfortunately, like we have a pandemic. We have a disease that can kill people, and people are running around engaging in cultural war performances. That's America today. That's how it is. We got to accept it. But there's also an underlying reality, and I think that's what we were on this podcast to talk about. Now, I wanna talk about something different. We kind of alluded to it. So when elections happen, I go to I think Predict It is your site.
Why electionbettingodds.com.
Election betting odds. Yeah, you do election betting. Predicted has other things.
Yeah.
So I go to election betting odds, you know, I basically do not listen to NPR or like read whatever Politico, because who cares, you know? And so I go to election betting odds. So how'd you get into betting? What do you think the future of betting is going to be? And do you think that this is a good thing in the world? I mean, I'm assuming you do, but you know, talk about why.
Yeah, I think it's super exciting. So I first covered this with John Stossel, who I work with, back in 2007. when betting markets were on politics were really new. And then, but these betting sites, they're often very hard to read, and there are many of them. And there are ones in the US, ones in Europe. They have different user bases because of regulations. So what my site does is I aggregate them. So I take Predictit, and I take Betfair and Polymarket and a bunch of others, and I put it together into a percentage to make clear like what's going to happen. So if we look at like who's going to be the Democrat nominee, Joe Biden has like 35% chance. Harris is at 16% chance. She's like way down since inauguration. There's lots of interesting stuff there, but big picture, it's exciting because these markets are kind of no bullshit. Like, it's not just people like, oh, I think this is going to happen. I think that their money's on the line. Often a lot of money, more than $1 billion was bet in the last election. People are still laying bets for the upcoming ones. So it's exciting because it's no bullshit. And I like figuring out what's going to happen. I like figuring out the truth. And it's sort of like applying the stock market instead of to just companies to like the future. And I think that's really cool. It's really taking off. There are more and more companies starting up doing this that I'm adding to the site to aggregate. And it's a super exciting space. By the way, the Roe decision has made an impact on the 2022 election. Like the Republican odds of taking the Senate fell from about 74 to 60. And I also have a map here, Senate seats in 2022. Many states flipped since Roe, like Pennsylvania, Georgia, Arizona, all shifted from slightly more likely to go Republican to slightly more likely Democrat. And they shift from red to blue on the map automatically. And that's really interesting to follow. And we've more stuff.
Yeah. I don't want to like say too much, 'cause like, you know, some of my listeners get annoyed if I express my own views, but I will just say that, most people are pretty moderate on this issue, and the parties are basically driven by people at the ends. And so that's causing a weird tension. And I can tell you personally, I'm just going to say it. These pro-life activists that are talking about extraterritoriality, they're crazy, and they're going to make like every college educated person in this country vote Democrat. I mean, they just need to shut up. It's not going to happen. It's not constitutional.
Yeah.
And they're just fantasizing. They're high on their own supply. Like, I don't normally talk about stuff like this in this tone on this podcast. Probably going to get some complaints. But the point here is, the people like Stacey Abrams said, abortion is between a doctor and the patient and a woman. And it's like, it's medical, it's not political. It's not true. Like, whether you think the fetus is a human being or not is a political, ethical, social, moral issue. That's just a fact. I'm sorry. I don't want to alienate listeners, but that's true. Right. Yeah. And then, the other issue though is like, the pro-life side needs to understand they got a big victory, but, hubris comes before the fall. Like, do not go around thinking you can sue people. I mean, seriously, I'm just being serious. If they actually like talk loudly about this, they don't know what they're in for, because a lot of people that will accept the overturning of Roe v. Wade and turning it back to the states will see like Handmaid's Tyranny if that comes out.
Yeah,
I mean, a lot of people roll their eyes at Handmaid's Tale stuff, but like that seriously is freaking people out.
Yeah, I think the betting odds reflect that. Now, to be clear, they still show the Republicans are more likely than not to take the Senate, but it'll be narrower. I agree with you that the extremism does not pay. And we've seen that for the Democrats too, I think. Like, they're unpopular partly because they backed, defund the police to much more extent than they should have, and things like that.
There's this whole empirical world out there, politically, everyone knows what'll win, but can you get through the primary and the interest groups and the way the structure is set up? And, that's why I like betting markets, because like, instead of just BSing, be like, okay, like, what do you want to bet on it? And, I made a fair amount of money actually on the 2012 election, but I arbitraged it. I took odds on both sides.
Nice. Yeah, that's 2012. You're an OG.
Yeah, I tried. Yeah, well, I mean, I you know, Kaplan introduced me to the idea. So I actually, I would do this in graduate school. I mean, maybe I shouldn't, like, you know, tell this personal story, like, on the podcast, try to be serious here. But I would make bets with people on things that were empirical that they kind of didn't want to be true. Mm. And so they would bet with me.
Nice.
But I knew I was right. And so a friend of mine, when interviews would happen, apparently, like, it got around, they would be like, "This is, don't go here. This bar is really bad. And don't make a bet with Razib."
That's funny.
Because the way I would do it is, like, I obviously would not give away that I knew what the truth was. Mm-hmm. I'd be like, "Well, I think you're wrong on that." You know, and I just kind of, like, you know, kind of, like, convince people into, you know, putting a bet down with me. And then, you know, then I would collect. So, but, like, you know, it imposes some discipline. What, Maxim?
You're like a card shark, but with money. Yeah.
Well, but it imposes some epistemological discipline on people.
Absolutely. I love it. Yeah.
You know, because people know that, like, not to, like, because, you know, I had, like what happened in 2012 is I had a friend. He's like, there's no way Romney's not going to win. And then I had another friend, no way Obama's not going to win. And I'm like,
arbitrage.
Yeah. Would you want to take 10-1 odds on that?
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they're like, wait, what? 10-1? I'm like, well, you said no way. Like, you're 100% sure, right? So that should be fine. And they're like, okay. So yeah, I took 10-1 odds on both of them.
Yeah, that's great. But yeah, it does impose, like, discipline on people. And it would be cool if it became even more of a norm on intellectual circles. Like, oh, you think he's sure to win? Okay, you want to bet. And, you know, people like Robin Hanson, Brian Kaplan are helping spread this idea. And I think it's great. By the way, on the betting site, we've got there are markets for these things, and people are betting on all sorts of things, like, will Elon Musk be Twitter CEO in this year? And it's close to 50-50, but slight edge for him not becoming CEO of Twitter this year. So that's interesting.
Well, what about the acquisition?
We don't have bets on that yet. This CEO is obviously closely related to that.
Yeah. Okay. That's interesting.
Yeah. You know, we also have things like, will Trump run? That's about 68%.
Yeah.
So probably will, but he's still, it's not a surefire thing.
Go ahead. I mean, there's a problem with these sorts of things where it's like, I believe you, you know, and it's mm-hmm. with the election where it's like 70%, 30% chance that it's not true. Yeah. So, but it's not like you're not going to do, like, 27 repetitions of this so you can actually validate your confidence and your point estimate, right?
You know, I've been – site's been up since 2015, and we do have a couple hundred things we've tracked, mostly, like, state elections, but we can tell they are valid within, let's say, 10 to 20%. So if the odds say 66%, you can be pretty sure it's actually between, let's say, 55 and 75%, like, in terms of historically how many times it actually happens. So, like, that's a lot more information than no information, right? Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, okay, it'll probably happen. So to me, it's still pretty informative based on the historical data. We've also got things like, is Putin going to stay in office through the end of the year, which is correlated, of course, with whether Russia will, do well against Ukraine or not. He's got a 13% chance of getting kicked out, which I would get would only happen if they see major setbacks with, like, the new long range artillery the Ukrainians are getting. So
wait, how long before the invasion of Ukraine were you in Russia?
I was there until 4 days after the invasion. And it was very interesting because I talked with some people there, like, what do you think about this? And I was surprised. I wrote a whole post about this on the Maximum Truth Substack. But I was surprised that many people I talked to were like, yeah, we do support the war. People have been oppressed in eastern Ukraine, and we're just helping them out. And so it was, I was surprised to see that. That people were buying the propaganda. I left a couple of days after.
Well, you know, it's like they're they're not like Americans. You know, like we in 1990, we liberated Kuwait from Saddam to reimpose freedom and democracy in that country.
Yeah, you know, we American foreign policy has major black eyes for sure. So
yeah, I mean, I'm not justifying the Russians, but yeah. You know, Americans do not know.
Go ahead.
No, I'm just saying it's like I've talked to people that say very similar things, and they have no idea the regime that we are propping
That's
up.
That's very true. Yeah, the U.S. You know, in the Middle East, the U.S. has sometimes been worse than Russia. Like in Syria, the U.S. policy effectively like prolonged the civil war because we were just there was no end game. We were just supporting the rebels who had no chance of winning, and it was just getting people killed for just. not accomplishing anything. And we've often backed Saudi Arabia, Russia having to back Iran, which is actually commits less, was fueling less terrorism there than Saudi Arabia. So it's all a mess. And Russia's invasion is also horrible.
Well, I mean, how many Americans know most of the 9/11 bombers were Saudi?
Right.
Very few.
Yeah.
And there's a reason for that. You know, I mean, if you're an American pundit class person, who shouts that out, like no more fellowship for you, you know, money makes, you know, and everyone's got their price, you know, for $1 billion, I'll talk about, how great North Korea is. So just, yeah, you know, my number, Mr. Kim, or I don't know. Just, you know, I'm having a little too much fun here, and probably like someone's going to like splice that out and say that I'm a bought and paid agent for North Korea, but you know, if I got $1 billion from North Korea, would I be here talking to Maxim Lott on a podcast? You know, actually, I probably would.
Yeah, it's fine.
I probably would.
What else are you going to do in your time?
Yeah. Anyway, all right. I think we touched all the topics. Maxim, your Substack is maximumtruth.substack.com. And what's your Twitter handle?
It's just Maxim Lott. Lott.
And you are not named after a gun. I do want people to know that. We discussed that before you got on. So.
Nor the magazine.
Yeah, I mean your older brother is not named Kalashnikov. All right. It was great talking to you, and you have a good day, man.
Yeah, great talking with you, Razib.
All right, take care.
Bye.
This podcast for kids.